Recall that a Turing machine always starts in the initial state and with its head over the first position on the tape. As it computes, its internal state, the tape contents, and the head position will change, but everything else will stay the same. We call this triple of state, tape content, and head position a configuration. And any given computation can be thought of as a sequence of configurations. It starts with the initial state, the input string, and with the head on the first location, and it proceeds from there. Now, it isn't very practical to always draw a picture like this every time that we want to refer to a computation of a Turing machine, so we develop some notation that captures the idea. Actually, we'll rewind the computation we just did and do it again, this time writing down the configuration using this notation. We write the start configuration as Q0, 1, 0, 1, 1. The part to the left of this state represents the tape contents to the left of the head. It's just the empty string in this case. Then we have the state of the machine, and then the rest of the tape contents. After the first step, a 1 is to the left of the head. We're still in state Q0, and this is the rest of the string, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. In the next configuration, 1, 0 is to the left of the head. We're still in state Q0, and 1, 1 is the rest of the tape contents, and so on and so forth. This notation is a little awkward, but it's convenient for typesettings. It's also very much in the spirit of Turing machines, where all structured data must ultimately be represented as strings. If a Turing machine can handle working with data like this, then so can we. At a slightly higher level, a whole sequence of configurations like this captures everything that a Turing machine did on a particular input. And so we will sometimes call such a sequence a computation. And actually, this representation of a computation will be central as we discuss the Cook-Levin theorem in the section on complexity.